Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this session of LitFestx. We have with us senior journalist and writer Avijit Ghosh, who's actually the senior editor at the Times of India newspaper in New Delhi. And Avijit has written quite a few books, and the one we are talking about today is his latest piece on a latest work on Bollywood and cinema. And going straight into it, Avijit, welcome to the show. And tell us a little bit about your latest book, which is called 40 Retakes, Bollywood Classics You May Have Missed.
Yeah. Kumar, thanks a lot first for inviting me on the show. And it's wonderful to attend LitFest I'm attending in boxer shorts, and that's quite an incredible thing. To go to the book, it's called 40 Retakes because it's basically a look back at movies, which films are basically judged on two kind of barometers. One is popular success, and the other is critical acclaim. And when a film doesn't meet either of these two criteria or fails to achieve either of these two benchmarks, then it falls through the cracks of memory and people forget about it. And I thought that a lot of good films over the years and over the decades have been excellent movies, but they have not got the recognition and they deserved. So this was just a way of going back and revisiting those movies and talking to people who were involved with these movies to find out what exactly went wrong and why these memories deserve. It's a way also of reintroducing these movies to a new generation so that they can go and see these movies.
Tell me, how did you come about this number of 40? I mean, it could have been a more sort of sellable number, 25, 50, 75, yeah. 10, I don't know.
No, you're perfectly right. Actually, I belong to the generation where films were celebrated in jubilees. 25 was silver jubilee, 50 was golden jubilee, 60 was diamond jubilee, 75 was platinum jubilee. So, and generally we are a country, which basically goes by, these kind of numbers. Sachin has got this many hundreds. So we are like that. But and in fact, I had initially planned it to put a number like 50. But what happened is when I started doing the number, I thought that I was not getting the quality number of films to fit into this thing. So rather than go by the number, I decided to settle for a number which is not unusual, but which meets more the requirements of the book.
Right. And Did you follow a very set process, certain parameters to filter movies which make the cut finally in the book?
Yeah, movies are generally these kind of any lists are very subjective, But I basically followed 2-3 patterns. One was that films which are very good, very successful, I generally kept them out. I went through, say, the encyclopedia of cinema, as well as all the lists, which Wikipedia lists and other lists, which put together the all the movies which have been released in a particular year. And I came down, and I also went to my memory shelf, spoke with friends who are interested in cinema, and I created a list of say 100 movies. From that list of 100 movies, bringing it down to 40 was quite a difficult task, because but after I came to 50 again, I found that actually if I be a little more rigorous, 40 is a good number. But I'd like to tell you something else about this. There's certain movies which I wanted to include, but I couldn't because they are not available. I have only included movies which I have been able to see. For instance, there was this great film called Phir Bhi in 1971, made by Shivendra Sinha, and it got the national award. And I somehow tried to track the movie, and I couldn't track the movie. I tried to speak to the people involved with the movie, Urmila Bhatt, who played a major role in the film, she was murdered sometime back, so I couldn't have spoken with her. There was Pratap Sharma, who was in the lead, and you know, he also passed away, you know, while I was researching on the book. I tried to talk to his daughter Tara Sharma, who was actually the heroine in you know, Khosla Ka Ghosla, but somehow I couldn't get hold of the movie. Then, you know, there was this Kamal Amrohi movie, a classic called Daira, you know, one of the great films that he made. It is basically love as denial, and I was hugely interested in that. But it was not available when I was writing the book. Later, now the film is available on YouTube, you know. Then Ved Rahi's Prem Parbat, which has this great song, Ye Dil Hai Aur Unki Nigahon Ke Saaye, you know, I wanted to do that, at least have a look at that film, but I couldn't do those films. So it's a very personal kind of a list.
So you actually had, you know, trouble featuring some of the movies, you know, because, you know, they actually didn't do well at all, and they are no longer available for viewing.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. That, you know, these, you know, there are actually quite a few good movies which are actually not available. You know, you have to go to the National Archives, and even there are, you know, the Pune Archives, and they are not available. So you try to scrounge, you know, the VCD markets, you know, in Lajpat Rai market in Delhi or Palika Bazaar, try to find out about these movies so that, you know, you don't miss out on a good movie. But it was not easy, you know, because not everything is available.
So that means in many ways, some of the movies which were really, let's say in your view, good movies, but because they were unpopular or because they didn't do well, which could have made it to the list, or rather those were stronger contenders to be made, you know, to be featured in the book, because you know, they were even more unpopular than some of the ones which are here, actually couldn't come in because, you know, they were better candidates in a way. You know, they
felt better. True. You know, there are some movies which I've taken. For instance, Mere Apne, you know, by Gulzar, which is Gulzar's first movie as a director, which did reasonably well. But, you know, but I have included that movie in the list because, you know, some movies change meaning over a period of time. You know, when Mere Apne was first released in the early 70s, it was a movie on student unrest. Because, you know, the 70s is a strong period of student unrest, you know, right from the West, you know, where you have this French student movement, and, you know, it's getting its echoes in India, you know, there's Naxal Bari and all. So there is a lot of student unrest, and he tried to capture that. But now when you go back and you see the film, you find that the parallel track of the movie, you know, which involves Meena Kumari, you know, and the way she's treated by her family is equally interesting. So this movie, I thought, was no longer a movie about youth unrest. It was a movie about aging, you know, aging in a society which is getting increasingly, you know, consumeristic and individual, and how we treat the elderly. So, these are interesting things which I found in certain movies, which made them, you know, which I found, which is why I thought that they needed a kind of a relook, so that we could reanalyze them and reposition them in the hierarchy of movies, you know, in our mind.
You know, interesting point you mentioned there. So there are, I'm sure, in every few years, a bunch of movies which one can say were good movies. You know, they were well made, and or they were entertaining, or they had a good message, and, you know, all in all were good movies, but they didn't do well in that day and time. Either one could say that because of the multiplex era and, you know, the need for movies to be doing well immediately, either because of that or because of the barrage of movies that are being released today. I mean, there could be multiple reasons, but give us an example of some of the movies which you felt that they didn't do well at the time when they were launched, but then later on, let's say on the broadcast and television space, they have found newer audiences.
You see, two, three movies that immediately come to my mind is Hasil, Tigmarshu Pulia's first film as a director. Then a Kabir Kaushik movie, which called Seher, which was directed, starred Arshad Warsi. These are two movies which immediately come to mind. And also Ram Gopal Varma's movie Raat. You know, Ram Gopal Varma, to do these profiles of movies, I went back and spoke to, you know, the producers, cinematographers, directors, musicians, wherever I could. And Ram Gopal Varma said that now he gets calls from the Z, you know, that the movie is a big hit, you know, in the late night the cable circuit, you know, people keep on showing that movie and it's very, very popular. Similarly, Hasil, when it was released, you know, a movie on violent student politics in UP, Allahabad University to be precise, this movie did not do well. In fact, you know, it did not even get great reviews, you know, although Shobha Day gave it a good review, but generally speaking, it not get great reviews. But now it is hailed as a classic. And if you go to, you know, to online, you will also find certain dialogues of Hasil, which have become kind of, which have become cult dialogues. And, you know, there are also sort of small film groups which keep on discussing these dialogues of Hasil. Similarly, Seher is a stunning, stunningly authentic movie which was based on the UP mafia, and a lot of mafia movies that have come in the past 5 to 10 years were like that. Then again, you know, Sudhir Mishra's film Is Raat Ki Subah Nahi, you know, did not do you know well when it was first released, but now it has become a kind of a movie which is which actually, you know, created the modern Bollywood mafia style book. You know, it was that kind of a movie, and people. I'm told, you know, Sudhir Mishra was told by Ram Gopal Varma that now that you have made Is Raat Ki Subah Nahi, I can make the movies that I want to make, and movies like, you know, Satya followed. So in a way, we can say that, you know, if these movies, you know, these movies are precursors, but the problem with precursors are that they are precursors, you know, they are not the real thing, you know. So if we can go back and say that they are precursors, but because they are precursors, they are not sort of as successful or, you know, as when they're before their time. So when the time comes, somebody else benefits from what they did.
So, you know, one of the slightly more contemporary movies, I think, in your list is Andaaz Apna Apna.
No. Andaaz Apna Apna does not make to my list.
Okay.
You know? Yeah. Andaaz Apna Apna does not make to my list. Okay. And there's a reason for that. That while many people feel it's a great movie, and I also enjoy it in parts, I really didn't feel that the parts, you know, synergize the whole, you know. And I find the early part of the movie, you know, the early part of the movie doesn't work for me. And while it has developed over the years a kind of elements which has made it a cult movie, I think that it falls short in my estimation to be you know, there.
So, you know, like you mentioned, you know, this particular movie was, you know, in your view, not as good as a whole as some of its parts were. Which ones are in your list of 40 in the book, which you really think that our generation, you know, the current generation should certainly go out and watch?
I'd strongly recommend a movie like, say, Rocket Singh, you know. Now, Rocket Singh had Ranbir Kapoor. It had a Yash Raj backing, but somehow the film did not do well at the box office, you know. And if you see Rocket Singh, you know, it really, really captures, you know, this whole direct sales generation, you know how their problems and how they deal with life. I thought it was quite a milestone movie, and with very, very good acting by especially the ensemble, you know. See how Prem Chopra, you know, in the role of a grandfather of Ranbir Singh, how he effortlessly slips into the role. And then there are actors like Naveen Kaushik, you know, and others, you know, and also the gentleman who plays Mr. Puri, you know, they have done so well in this film. It has, you know, this direct sales kind of a system that we talk about, you know, Jaideep Sahni, the writer of the film, he told me that there are a lot of what he called the wounded soldiers, you know, left, you know, people who work hard but fail to make it, you know. So this film, you know, basically walks the line of what I call the ethical template, you know, of doing business. You know, what is right, what's the right way to do business, and whether that there is hope in succeeding in the right way to do business or not. Because the owner of the company that Rocket Singh works for initially represents an entirely different kind of, you know, ethical, you know, he's an amoral, you know, character. things different than something else. So this whole clash of, you know, two different kind of ways of looking at life and business was very, very interesting.
Right. But Avijit, in your, I mean, since you have dug deep into the possible reasons why you have, said these 40 movies were good, and then you've obviously, done some research on the reasons probably why they failed to make a mark at the time of their release in that year or in that era. Give us some broad points on what do you think is happening? You know, why is it that we've had some of these fantastic movies like you're suggesting, which didn't do well in that time?
You know, films succeed and flop for very, very different reasons. But let me give you a kind of four or five broad reasons why the makers involved in the film, they say they flopped. I spoke to Simi Grewal, for Teen Deviyan, which makes the cut in my book. And she said that the film flopped because it was a black and white movie. And it came at a time when color was already, had already arrived in Hindi cinema. But black and white had not entirely faded away. So people did not visit the movie, which was actually, Teen Deviyan is a romantic comedy, if you can call it. And it's a very modern story on indecision in love. So, you know, it needed color, the film. But she says that that was one of the reasons why it flopped. Other films flop. Most directors have this grudge that their films were not marketed properly. They feel that if these films were marketed properly, then probably they had a chance. For instance, Hustle, needed better marketing. I also feel that some movies, since they were precursors, they came at a time, they were essentially multiplex movies, but they were released when multiplexes had not arrived in big numbers. So essentially they were shown in single screen theaters, and the more sophisticated and refined middle class, which enjoys a certain kind of multiplex movies at that time, had stopped going to single screen theaters. And so these movies did not get the audience that they deserved. And finally, when they got the audience that they deserved via DVDs and on television, then they have become cult movies in their own right.
Let me talk to you on two points you mentioned there. So when you say that some of these movies probably didn't do well because they were not marketed properly. So when you're saying marketed properly, do you really mean about the positioning of the movie to the audiences of that day and age? Or is it really just about the sheer level of promotion of those movies?
Kind of both. Because, so for instance, it is very important to send the right message about a movie, including, for instance, let me take a movie like Seher. Now, Seher in Urdu means morning. It does not, the movie's title did not reflect what the movie actually was, Now, again, take a movie which makes my list and which I really love as a movie is Antardwant. Now, Antardwant was basically means internal dilemma. Now, internal dilemma does not represent the film at all, So that is one thing, not being able to put forward what you are. But apart from that, if you saw the promos of Rocket Singh, it had a slightly, slightly humorous touch. We were expecting a humorous movie, which Rocket Singh is not. But some films also did not do well because they were not promoted in the sense, it's only in the last 5 to 10 years that Bollywood has woken up to publicity and promotion in a big way. Now, what has happened earlier, say an average Bollywood film would spend, say, about 2 to 3% on its promotion. Whereas Hollywood goes as far as high as 30 to 40%. Now, Bollywood films are being promoted, a lot of budget is going into promotion. So at least people are coming to know of what the films are. Films like Hustle and even Seher, I would say, did not get the sort of that kind of promotion or a promotional backup in terms of advertisement with the dessert.
So speaking of promotion, and as you mentioned, increased promotional budgets in Bollywood today, aren't we also seeing a trend that, you know, some movies which one could argue are really not good movies, but because of the promotional budget, because of the sheer number of screens that they open with, before people get a chance to, you know, do a word of mouth and say, you know, it's not a great movie, it has already become a super hit in the first 2-3 days itself.
Yeah, you see, that is essentially a marketing ploy that, you know, but it has come out of a certain kind of a necessity. You see, what happened in the 80s is that piracy came in a very big way in world cinema, and a substantial number of profits was eaten into by piracy. Now Hindi films went through a bad phase because they did not know how to encounter piracy. Now what has happened is that because of the multiplex and because of, you know, being able to show films at, say, in about 3,000 to 5,000 screens at a go, they have been able to offset the negativities of piracies to some extent. But, you know, every story has two sides, and the second side of the story is that now films don't get a second chance beyond the first weekend. So if a film works in the first 3 days, you know, it's fine. If it doesn't work, then it does not get a chance to make a comeback. Earlier, films, you know, good or bad, were shown for at least 4 to 6 weeks or 8 weeks, you know, in the cinema halls in the urban areas. So, you know, there was something called word of mouth publicity, and that kicked in over a period of time, and you know, films became popular. For instance, Pakiza, Meena Kumari's classic, was released, and it was dismissed as a sort of a film that people were not liking, and, you know, it was on the verge of becoming a flop and being taken off the cinemas. Then Meena Kumari passed away, and suddenly there was renewed interest in the movie, and people started thronging the theaters, and they started liking the movie also. So the film got a second chance, and now it is hailed as a super hit and as a classic. But now in modern times, films don't get that second chance. And, you know, they just, you know, if you don't watch those movies if a film doesn't click in the 3-4 days, then it's gone.
Right. And, you know, in terms of movies which are finding new audiences today on television, do you think, you know, this is really because it's from the comfort of one's home, and, you know, people are able to just choose between several channels which are playing old movies again and again? Or is it really because those old movies are now actually finding favor with these audiences because of the messaging or because of the content purely? What do you think is happening there?
Look, film watching is an expensive business. You know, say on an average, you spend about $1,000 or $2,000, you know, watching a movie on a weekend, if you go with a family, say of 3 to 4, you'd be spending, say, more than $2,000. Now, $2,000 is big money for most Indians, barring, say, the 10 to 15% or 20% of the creme la creme of society. So not everybody can afford to watch as many movies in cinema halls as he or she wants to. So what is happening is people are choosing their movies. Say you may watch one or two very good movie that you want to watch. So, for instance, you know, people came out in big numbers to watch Tanuved's Manu Part 2 or Queen, you know, Bajrangi Bhaijaan. These are movies that really got people out of homes, and they went there because they thought that the movie really deserved it. They had heard it by word of mouth that it's worth it. Many movies which you want to see, you know, you're just a little on the 50-50 side. You prefer not to see it in the theaters, and you rather wait because, you know, these films are anyway, you know, sort of premiered within a month or two. One of the problems with these movies is that there are a lot of ads, so that puts people off. But even watching a movie back home on a DVD or a VCD, you know, works out to far better economics. As for the older movies, you know, they are now available. Many of them are available not only on television. People are consuming a lot of movies, especially people who are interested in you know, meaningful cinema and deep cinema. They're consuming a lot of movies through YouTube, through, you know, which are and other, you know, video broadcasting sites. where lots of movies are stored. So people, a lot of people now technology has offered options to people to connect with a lot of movies in a lot of ways, and a lot of people are doing that.
Right. I think this brings us to a point where we can, I think, take some questions, Avijit, from the audience, the online viewers. We are getting a stream of steady stream of questions. I'm just going to pick one or two. So this one question from Bani Singh, and she says, does the current cinema offer any hope to bring back the golden era?
Look, I think the golden era is a myth. It's a myth created by, everybody thinks that his era is golden. And I think when, say, 20 years from now, this era will be seen as golden. You know, when really a lot of good movies were happening. So, old is gold. It's not only a cliche. It is actually, a mythology that has been built over the years. But having said that, I would say that every age has its own special set of movies. It is movie is something that we, is something something that suits our sensibilities is what we look forward to. Something that we can empathize with is something look forward to. Something that we are in tune with that we look forward to. So some people are able to tune better with the past. So they probably find golden or whatever you call it. I personally feel that 1957, was a great year for movies and probably the best year ever, for movies, in the sense that we had a huge range of movies in that year, from Tum Saane Dekha to Mother India. It had that range. Probably nowadays we are getting a lot of good movies, but that whole the sheer numbers of good movies to some extent has come down.
Right. The next question which I'm taking is, it says that what do you have to say about the current generations leaning towards more of Hollywood films?
Yeah, they do probably, it's all part of globalization. But you can also see this is a very class-based question. You'd say that the urban public school generation always was inclined towards Hollywood. Probably, they are much more accessible now, so they are leaning towards it. But let us also not forget, at the same time, when people are moving towards Hollywood, there is also another set of youngsters who are also gravitating towards Bhojpuri movies, towards regional Punjabi movies, towards even Chhattisgarhi movies. So India exists at many levels and with many hierarchies, and everybody is getting that the choice to choose what he wants to, what he or she wants to.
Right. So Avijit, that brings us to the end of this very fascinating session with you, and I'm sure you've really taken a lot of trouble, like you mentioned, of sifting through hundreds and hundreds of movies and to come down to this 40 and then describing them with the kind of lens you have used. And we wish your book tremendous success. I'm sure cinema and movie connoisseurs will want to read the book and see what they have been missing. On a parting note, do you have any words about LitFestx to our audience?
I think it's a fascinating fascinating project. It's innovative, it's inventive, and in a sense, it is the way of the future.
Great, thank you, Avijit, and we look forward to doing future sessions with you. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.